talking about your nervous system. Now, at first blush, nervous system doesn't really seem to have a lot of practical value, but I would argue that it does, and it can revolutionize the way you look at your world. Because the thing that you do when you look at your world is not what you think you do. You think that you see reality. You think that you hear reality. You think that you touch reality and that you smell reality, but you don't do any of those things directly in the way that you normally think that you do. Every experience you have with reality is indirect. It's red, if you will. Stimuli exist outside the body. Stimuli exist inside the body. But you wouldn't be aware of any of those stimuli if it weren't for your brain and nervous system activity. So I don't see you the way most people think of the word see. If you are lucky enough to have the gift of sight, the way that it works is that photons, energy, is beaming down from these sources of light, reflecting off of you. Some of it's being absorbed and some of it's reflecting back. That's what is reflecting back is going through the lenses of my eyes. If they were clouded, I wouldn't see you. And they are then landing on the back of my eye, in the retinal area. And then they are triggering impulses. So I have a physical energy source outside that then impacts my body in a way that fires a neuron. And that neuron, the rods and the cones of the eyes, which allow us to see, trigger electrical and chemical impulses in a cascading effect that reaches the back of my brain in an area we'll talk about later called the occipital lobe. And it's upside down when it gets there. And the brain corrects for that, turns it right side up, which is how we've learned to see our world around us. And it provides me an internal model of an external thing. Does that make sense to you? Everything that we think we're experiencing directly, we're actually experiencing indirectly. If any part of that visual system were to be terminated, the sense of vision would be terminated. Anybody ever go caving or spelunking and turn off your light when you get to that middle part and you see what darkness really is? You have no sense of sight without light. It doesn't exist anymore. It's gone. All the objects in the room are still there, right? Reality didn't change. Your perception of reality changed. Your inability to see it was dependent upon a light source which no longer exists, right? And likewise, if I was to have lesions in my brain, I could have blindness at a number of stages. If my optic nerve was to be severed or damaged for some reason, I might cease to be able to see. If it was fine and got all the way back to my occipital lobe and I had major damage in the tissues back there, I may no longer be able to see. Everything I think I see is actually an internal model of an external reality mediated by the nervous system. So it's a complicated thing. It's integrated, it's adaptive, and it's electrochemical, which has a little asterisk on it, which means it might be something you'd want to know for a bonus item on your test. We'll be explaining electrochemical. In other words, I want to emphasize the electrochemical transmission of information that we have inside the nervous system. So let's start at the basics. A neuron is a cell. It's a cell that functions. It's an active cell. The neuron receives, organizes, and transmits information. So it's a complicated cell. It's a busy cell. It's an absolutely necessary cell to have any kind of functioning whatsoever. Certain areas of your brain stop working, you're well aware, you stop working, you'll die. In other words, we have to have this biological substrate to our existence. To the degree that we are metaphysical creatures with souls, that transacts with this reality through a biological vehicle, a body, a mind. The body itself responds to the mind. Without these neurons, we got nothing. I'm going to break it down into a couple types of neurons here. I'm going to have my sensory neurons. They are perceiving information. In other words, they're translating energy from outside of me to a different kind of energy inside of me, which I then read, quote unquote, as reality. So if somebody touches me, then I have a touch receptor. That takes information into my brain, that touch does. Just that stimulus on that set of neurons. And that allows me to perceive the feeling, right? Same thing with sight, same thing with sound. I have outside coming inside. Well, what's carrying it in are the neurons we're just going to call afferent neurons. Afferent is taking information into the CNS, which is just shorthand for central nervous system. If you're taking notes, it's good to come up with shorthand so you're not having to write everything out longhand, right? Shorthand will speed things up and allow you to put more information into the same space in less time. Interneurons are going to come into play after the signal has arrived from the outside, and they'll also come into play when signals are originated from the inside. Interneurons, connectivity, like interstate, goes between states. Interneurons go between areas of the brain. So I've got my afferent neurons bringing information into the brain, and then I've got interneurons which distribute information around the brain. And then, of course, to do anything, I would have to have some output as well. For me to walk across the stage while I'm talking and not even think about walking across the stage while I'm talking, I have to have neural information transmitted to effector organs, in this case, muscles. I got muscles that allow me to walk and to gesticulate with my hands and arms, and also to speak by modulating my jaw, my vocal cords, and the amount of air that passes across them, while coming up with what I might say next. All of it going on simultaneously through this complex integrated network of activity. So now I've got neurons that are carrying signals out of the CNS, out of the central nervous system. Those are what we're going to call efferent neurons. Afferent, efferent. That can be confusing, so I would suggest that anytime you can, you develop mnemonics to help you remember little tricks of memory, which aren't really tricks at all. They make you work with the information more. But if you remember A comes before E, then you'll know that A is the sensory and E is the output, right? Input, output. A comes before E. So sensory neurons, afferent, motor neurons, efferent. So you have a system integrated from end to out and all about in between. Now, the transmission of information, and that might even be the question itself, goes across structures of the neuron that we're going to talk about in some detail. They come in through the dendrite, they are summated in the soma, which is your cell body, and if that information is to be passed on, it will go out through the axon. Now that is the progress of information across a neuron. That doesn't tell us whether the neuron's an afferent neuron, an interneuron, or an efferent neuron. All neurons will function in basically the same way, although there are very different kinds of neurons to keep in mind, right? We've already designated three different classes of neurons. But every neuron's going to have dendrites, a soma, an axon, and breaking it down, dendrites where you receive information. What kind of information would that be? Well, largely we're talking about, especially in the interneurons and motor neurons, it would be chemical in nature, it'd be neurotransmitters, right? And in the case of your sensory neurons, that would be the first point of contact. So your photon hitting your retina triggers through the dendrites an action potential, as we'll call it, that then is sent out through the axons across the optic nerve, across the optic chiasm where it crosses over in sections of the brain to the occipital lobe in the back. But a dendrite is a specialized structure on the neuron that receives information, and we'll have some pictures of that in just a minute to make it a little more sensible. But that's what you're going to want to remember in terms of directionality. The soma is the cell body. Every cell has got a body. Right? That's where your nucleus is. That's where your organelles are. Your little mitochondria, little Golgi apparati, things floating around inside the intracellular space, which is full of fluid, intracellular fluid, versus extracellular, which is going to be housed in, we'll see, or at least is going to be present in the brain in a way that's critical to information transmission. And then we got this antenna-like structure. It's just a long projection out. They vary based on what kind of neuron you're looking at. It transmits signals to other neurons, so antenna-like in the sense that it broadcasts out as well. So three major sections, three major types of neurons. But they don't exist in isolation. They got to have a support network, a structure that holds them up and allows them to branch in the directions that they have to branch in, because, of course, they're in three-dimensional space. It's easy to talk about them in terms that look two-dimensional, but you think about your brain, it's not a huge organ, but it's a solid, seems like, set of mass, but it isn't a solid set of mass any more than any mass is solid, right? You break it down to the atomic level, and you find out that there's all these subparts and subparts and subparts and so on, but what we have is a bunch of cells whose job it is to support the neuronal network, to let them be propped up, and also to assist in nourishing the neurons and removing waste products away from them. So we have a much more complex set of cells to consider besides the neurons, which are the ones we really think of as functional, but they wouldn't function without other cells carrying out their functions, right? So the neurons are numerous and the glial cells are more numerous. And we'll talk about some specific glial cells, and you want to know that stuff. It's indented under white font neuron, so you have that sense that, gosh, I ought to know what a neuron is. But more than that, I want to know that there's at least three major types of neurons, and there's three major parts of neurons, and I need to know what they are and the order in which information is transmitted across them. If you know that, you are in good shape.